Hello and welcome. I'm James Murphy from mcoding.io, where I offer 9-week weekend programming courses. Today, Brownian motion. If you're watching this video, you've probably heard of Brownian motion before, but the purpose of this video is not so much to tell you what Brownian motion is, but rather to give you a way to simulate it so that you can play with it yourself. Surprisingly, simulating Brownian motion is actually not that difficult. I've already imported NumPy for doing some of the math operations and NumPy for plotting. The first thing that I'm going to do is define the number of time steps that I want to use and my time horizon. So this means that I'm going to be simulating Brownian motion from time 0 to time 1, and I'm going to do so using 10,000 sample points. Next, we'll use numpy.linspace to make the set of times that we're going to use. So linspace takes the initial time, the final time, and the number of sample points. Just for your benefit, let's go ahead and print out times with a small number of time steps so you can see what it's doing. You can see it's just going in uniform increments, 0 up until 1. Continuing on, I think the next thing that we're going to need is what is the time step that is between each of those times. So we'll just take times of 1 minus times of 0. The next thing that we need to figure out is how do we actually get values of the Brownian motion? Well, almost the characterizing property of Brownian motion is its independent, normally distributed increments. What that means is that if I have Brownian motion at some time t2, and I subtract Brownian motion at some time t1, well then this is a random variable, and it's normally distributed with mean 0 and variance t2 minus t1. So instead of trying to find a single formula for the Brownian motion, I'll just generate all of these normally distributed increments and then add them up. So let's make db, meaning the increments of Brownian motion, the differences between the values of the Brownian motion, that will be a numpy random normal, and let's give it a shape or size, which is equal to, we're going to need the number of time steps minus 1, because the first one is always going to be 0, Brownian motion starts at 0, then we need n minus 1 for the rest of the time steps. So by default, this is going to give me mean 0, variance 1, and what I need is variance dt. Because we're looking at increments of the Brownian motion, which are in times in this array, all of those times, consecutive times in that array, are separated by a distance of dt from each other. So in order to get a variance of dt, I'll need to multiply by the square root of dt. So let's just do that, numpy square root of dt times that. So db now is an array of differences of values of Brownian motion. We still haven't constructed any of the values yet, just their differences. To get the actual values of Brownian motion, we'll need to start with its value at 0 and then cumulatively add up the differences. So Brownian motion starts at 0, so let's just use numpy.zeros to create the array, and it takes a shape parameter, and we're just going to have 1, 0 for now. Later on, we're going to be generalizing to simulating multiple Brownian motions, or equivalently, a single multi-dimensional Brownian motion. So if you don't understand why we're choosing to make this 0 an array instead of just a scalar, just keep that in mind that we're going to be generalizing in a little bit. To get the actual values of the Brownian motion, we just need to concatenate the initial value with the cumulative sum of the increments. So I'll take these things to be concatenated. Let's take b0 and the cumulative sum of the increments. And then we can go ahead and just plot it. So we'll plot that. X values are the times and the y values are the Brownian motion. And then we'll show the plot. So if we did everything correctly, then we should see a plot of Brownian motion. All right, that looks pretty good to me. One thing that I do want to test is I just want to make sure that if we used less time points, that we're still getting the right thing. So I do see that it starts at 0 and it's going around the value -1. Of course, it's random, but the values that you get for Brownian motion shouldn't depend on the number of sample points, but only on the time horizon. So if I go out to t equals 1, it shouldn't matter if I take 10,000 sample points. I should still have something which is around the range +/-1. And you can see, even though it's a totally different sample path, different number of sample points, we do end up around 1. Now, of course, it's possible that that doesn't happen, but it's just the most likely thing is to be in that range, -1 to 1. If you did this experiment and you found that when you increase the number of sample points, that the value of your Brownian motion was increasing, then you probably would have messed up the scaling. So for instance, if I delete this proper scaling by square root of t, and then run the simulation again, so here you can see that by time 1, we're getting values that are up at like 80 and down to -50, almost -60. So if you see that, that should be your clue that Brownian motion doesn't move that much in that amount of time. So if that happens, check your scaling. I'll go ahead and put the proper scaling back in there. Okay, so that's one Brownian motion. What if we want to increase the number of samples? Let's introduce a new parameter d, which is the number of Brownian motions that we're going to simulate all at once. So for now, let's just have, say, 5 Brownian motions. So how can we modify this now? Our times are not going to change because they're all living on the same time axis. Since our times didn't change, our dt doesn't change either. The first thing that actually changes is going to be the increments. So instead of being normally distributed with this size, now we need to just add in a d here. The first coordinate is going to be our time coordinate, and the second coordinate is going to be our either space coordinate, if you're thinking of it as a multi-dimensional Brownian motion, or the index of the Brownian motion, if you're thinking about it as a bunch of independent one-dimensional Brownian motions, which is how it will be drawn when we plot it. Of course, now the initial value of the Brownian motion is going to be 1 by d, because there are d components of it now. Oh, and by the way, if you wanted to consider a Brownian motion that's not started at 0, this is exactly where you would change it. You just put in the numbers that you want there, and then you'll get samples of your Brownian motion started at that place. There are two things that we need to change on this line, namely, now that our db has more than one dimension to it, we need to specify when we do the cumulative sum and when we do the concatenation what axis we're doing that over. So I know that I want to sum in time, not in space. So I want to sum at the 0 axis, not the 1 axis. So let's change the cumulative sum to axis equals 0. And let's change the concatenation axis to axis equals 0 again. That's because I, again, want to concatenate B0 on as the first time step, not as a spatial dimension. Then we can go ahead and plot it again. So there you have it. It looks like we have a good 5 samples of Brownian motion going. Just for fun, let's bump up the number of Brownian motions and see what it looks like when we do 100. If you've never seen a picture like this, I would encourage you to sit and stare at it for a while. It's a little bit mesmerizing. Even though our Brownian motion was made up of totally independent increments, every single one was just randomly generated, we're starting to see some structure here. Even with 100 sample paths, there's a clear shape that's emerging where the Brownian motion really tends to not go outside of that shape. Let me bump it up to 1,000 here, just so we can get a little bit better picture of that shape. Now we see a very defined shape with just a few outliers. Out of 1,000 samples, we have almost a parabolic shape that's emerging. If you're interested in learning about this property, it's actually a very well-known fact. you should look up what's called the law of the iterated logarithm for Brownian motion. It tells you that Brownian motion really tends not to exceed about square root of 2t, and from the name, you can guess that there's a logarithm or two hiding in there. But that's not for this video. This just shows that by simulating, you can gain a lot of insight into the statistical properties of a kind of random process like Brownian motion. The last thing that I wanted to show you is another key insight that you can see just by simulating like this. Another characteristic factor of Brownian motion, it has so many interesting properties, but one of them is its quadratic variation. Now, the quadratic variation isn't something that you would probably come up in a video just about Brownian motion. It's more of something that you can look at for a general stochastic process, and it just turns out to have a very interesting formula when you put in Brownian motion. The quadratic variation is not a whole lot more than what it sounds like. Basically, we're just going to take differences of the Brownian motion, square them, and add them. So let's take the NumPy difference of the Brownian motion along the axis 0, because remember, 0 was for time. And to preserve the original dimensions of the Brownian motion, I'll just go ahead and prepend 0, because the quadratic variation is something that's defined just like Brownian motion to start at 0. Then I'll take those differences and raise them to the power 2. Then I will again use the cumulative sum function so that I can graph them. And again, we'll do this along axis 0, that's the time axis. And then I will just return it. If you didn't quite follow the formulas and dimensions that went into this, just consider the case where d equals 1. Then all the axis stuff disappears, and what you end up having is basically look at the differences of the Brownian motion, take them to the power 2, and add them up. So now, instead of plotting b, let's plot the quadratic variation of b. Huh, that's weird. When you see this picture, you might think that I've done something wrong. Just to be sure that I haven't accidentally messed up the Brownian motion somehow, let's go ahead and plot again, just throw that original plot of b back in. So you can see the Brownian motion is still wiggling all over the place. It has all of the same properties that we were talking about before, but yet this quadratic variation looks like just a line. And indeed, that is the case. The property that I was alluding to earlier is that the quadratic variation of Brownian motion is just t. At time t, Brownian motion has had exactly t quadratic variation. That's why this looks like the line y equals x. So even though we have the full force of all the randomness of Brownian motion going on here, we find that when we look at squares of differences and add them up, all of these different sample paths look like this, just a line. So that's another key property of Brownian motion, and it's really cool that we can actually see it even just with our, you know, finite simulation. That's all I have for today on Brownian motion. Let me know if you want to see more on this topic. And as always, if you liked the video, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks. See you next time.